I am Jan. I flew in from the glorious city of Amsterdam, probably the coolest city in the world, apart from Singapore, of course. If you make cool pictures of me during this this event, tweet them to me. If you want to see my GitHub profile, it's also there. I'm always findable in the Jan Jongboom. So what we're going to do today is mostly talk about code. Despite my good looks, I'm not a marketing person. Well, I'm going to give you a 5-minute introduction of what Cloud9 is and the stuff that we do. Mainly so you have an idea of why we are facing the problems that I'm going to talk about today. So the world evolves fully around the web. Like viewing information on Wikipedia, doing
good.
So the world completely evolves around the web. And viewing information, Wikipedia, doing online banking, watching conferences if you can't attend. Everything is the web. You know, you never have to leave your browser to do the stuff that you want to do anymore. So we figured, if everything is on the web, then why do you like the C# developers, the Java developers? Everyone is like a traditional guy. Have all the perks, you know? They have like great IDEs, integrated testing suites, language analysis, static compilation. But if you're doing JavaScript, the language of the web, not so much. You know, a JavaScript developer, man, I'm happy with just syntax highlighting. I don't care about all the stuff. So we figure, we're going to build the best IDE for dynamic languages, especially JavaScript. And this is what we came up with. This is Cloud9. This is the thing we built. It looks gorgeous, looks awesome. Every time I start it up, I get, okay, I can't talk about that in Singapore. It's probably going to fine me if I say that. And what better way to embrace the web than to actually build this thing on the web? So Cloud9, an IDE, a real IDE, that you can write JavaScript in, Node.js applications, debugging, etc., but it runs in your browser. We still have a lot of cool features, so we do smart code completion with integrated documentation. Like, for example, this is Node.js documentation, just right there in your IDE. We do static analysis, so we analyze your code, and we tell you what's wrong with it, or eval is evil, or something, stuff like that. We tell you stuff about your code. And this is the coolest thing that we actually have. Because if you create a project on our hosted service, you've got an open source version, Cloud9 is open source. We offer a cloud version of the product as well. And if you create a project there, we give you a free Linux virtual machine. It just runs Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And it means that if you need CoffeeScript, install it. If you want to do MongoDB, install it. Want to play with 3.js after the workshop? Install it. I don't care. And to interact with that, we have a real terminal also in your browser, and you can even watch Star Wars the ASCII version in that. So, in the past 2 years, ever since we started the product, our code base has grown a lot. And at this moment, we have a code base of hundreds of thousands of lines of JavaScript. Holy fuck. Man. And also external modules, etc. So 400,000 lines of code in a dynamic, weakly typed language. That also runs on a single thread if you do it on a server, man. You have to be insane. If one thing goes wrong, your complete server goes down. Or your browser won't execute any JavaScript anymore. This developing in such an environment is complete madness. You know, a language without static compilation, no type safety. Make a mistake? And when we started our product, we decided to build on Node.js, which 2 years ago was completely unproven technology. Weird. So my solution to everything is modularization. Because modularization helps you So let's say we've grown from one single developer to 30 people working on a product. And when 30 people are working on a product, you have multiple feature teams. And all these feature teams are working on products. You can't say, all right, I'm very dependent on that. Don't break anything in there because I'm dependent on X and I'm dependent on Y and I'm dependent on Z. So if you do modularization properly, you can do black box coding. You know, I want a database. I don't care where it comes from. I don't want to know if it's Postgres or Mongo or whatever. Just need a database. I don't want to know anything about implementation details of that. There's an interface. It works. I don't care. So in the browser, for modularization, you have required.js. And on Node.js, you have common.js modules. Basically, it looks like this. It's like the principle that we know from Java via imports or C# with using. I require a module, and then I use it to do stuff. And this is very good at abstracting away pieces of external functionality. So think jQuery. It's a piece of external functionality. I'm just going to load it through require.js, maybe common.js, a request library, like little pieces of code that do not talk to other parts of your system. They're completely external. Very good at that, but it's not good at application level abstractions. So I have a database that is used in 10 different other plugins that I have. That's not really working if you do common.js modules or using require.js here. Because if you, for example, search your node modules folder on a simple project that you have in Node, you're probably going to find the same module 80 times because it's copied all over the file system, because the complete dependency tree is completely mapped on the file system. That's bad. And it also means that you can't really swap out dependencies at runtime. If I'm going to say I require jQuery, it will go to the file system, locate a jQuery folder, find the index.js there, and that's it. I can't just say, all right, now use jQuery from my memory. I don't have it on file system. And it's also hard to configure. So it returns the module. It doesn't return an instantiated object or something. So if I require a database, I still have to pass in my connection string. So I have to pass a global options object all around. And that's not going to work either, you know? But the very worst part of require and common.js for doing your app level dependencies, if you make a mistake in your dependency tree, so let's say I delete my database folder by accident, I'm not going to notice at startup time. You know? My server will just start up fine. But the very moment that I'm using that file, my complete server goes down. You know? Or my page doesn't start up. That's not nice. If you come from C#, you're like, all right, I delete the dependency, and now it says, yeah, hi, you're using a database, it's not there. Fix it before I can even compile it. So to address these problems, we created a library called Architect. Architect is the child of Tim Caswell, which is a Node.js developer that works for us. He made a shit ton of modules. So we developed this internally. And these are the principles behind it. So Architect revolves completely about plugins. Every piece of functionality is a plugin. Database, make it a plugin. jQuery, make it a plugin. Plugins can consume other plugins. It's nice. And an application is a set of plugins. Plugins, three times plugins. Architect, all about plugins. But the cool thing is that with Architect, the creation of the dependency tree, requiring your database, etc., is all done at startup time and not at runtime. So if you make a mistake there, your application will explode at the moment that you start it up, and not at the moment that you don't want it to crash at runtime. So dependency error handling architect style is more like this. You start coding, you start it up, but you made a mistake. Thing won't start up, and you already notice it before you even deploy your application. And that means happy customer, developer keeps you up, etc. So now we're going to talk code. We're actually going to talk code. We're going to give a code representation of this talk. So the thing we do, we get a speaker from the database. We let him talk. We let him brabble over a subject. And then we end with a little dance, because that's how we do things. So this is the code. Don't let it scare you. The first thing is that we create a data layer. You know, a simple database-like object that has a method, getSpeaker by name, and returns a speaker from our database. Then we print some information about him, you know, who he is, the company that he works for. Then we let him talk about a subject, and then we do a little dance. So when you execute this, it comes up like this. Pretty accurate, if you ask me. So Architect wants you to group these functions by behavior. So if you check this piece of code, we actually do two things. First of all, we create a data layer. And then we have a presentation that consumes this data layer to execute some code. If you have your dependency model, it looks like this. A presentation consumes data layer. In Architect, I can now create this dependency tree by describing this model in my package.json file. And describing my presentation consumes my data layer in a package.json file. So in my data layer, I say, I provide you a data layer. My plugin gives you a data layer. And the presentation itself says, I'm going to consume this data layer. Two blocks, very simple. So now we actually have to split this code because we have two behaviors and now two plugins. So we're going to extract the code, wrap it in Architect plugin code. It's like super little boilerplate, so I have 5 lines. And I make these two plugins. So in orange you see the Architect boilerplate code. We start with a function signature. And then we call a function when we're done. So you can do this asynchronous. And as you can see, we said earlier, I'm going to provide you a data layer in my package.json file. And in this case, I call register, and I give it a data layer. This is what I do. If I don't provide this thing, my application will explode. It will say, hey, you said you're going to give me a data layer. Did not happen. So the function signature has 3 arguments. The first one is options. We'll get to that a bit later. And then there's imports. Basically, everything that you consume, that you described earlier in your package.json file, I want to consume my data layer. If you do that, it's in the imports object. And then register, which you have to invoke when you're done. So this is the presentation code. Also, I added the boilerplate on the first line. And here we have the imports argument. I said earlier, I want my data layer there. So now I can get that from the imports object. And the rest of my code goes unchanged. But now my dependencies are abstracted away nicely. I have 2 plugins, 1 data layer, 1 presentation. They don't clutter together. That's very nice, because now my code is easily unit testable as well. So I can just mock my data layer dependency, inject it in the plugin, and make nice assertions. So a requirement presentation, just standard, normal require stuff. Then I mock a data layer, and I create a stub in SVG. Sorry. I create a stub from a talk function so I can assert stuff on it. Then I'm going to fake my dependencies here, and then make an assertion. Simple, you know? I abstracted my dependencies away, and now I have a file that's perfectly unit testable. Nice. So now we created two plugins, and Architect is not black magic or something. Because to build this dependency model, we need to feed it a list of plugins that Architect has to load. Just a simple array with file names. And after that, we call a create app function. Pretty simple. So this is my application startup code. It's like server.js if you do node.js. Bear in mind, it also works in the browser, but a little bit different. But I'm focusing here on Node because it's like JavaScript standalone stuff is easier. So I have a list here of two plugins that I'm going to load. And after that, I call the create app function. And then my application starts up. So let's remove the data layer now here from this list. You know, I'm going to break my dependency tree. Could not resolve dependencies of this plugin. Ta-da, you failed to provide a data layer. I'm not going to start up. So instead of at the moment that you're going to execute this presentation, your application fails at startup time already. Woo. So as I said before, we're going to get back to options. If you're using standard modules and you want to use your database there, you have to pass around your connection string along your whole application. That's not good. So with Architect, you have the possibility to have per plugin options. You have like an option, like the connection string, that's only relevant to a database. And then the only plugin that's ever going to notice that there is a connection string option is the database itself. Maybe it's no longer passing around the global options object. Just specify all your options in the config file. So in Architect boilerplate, the first argument is this options thing. And I'm going to use this now to make the length of the talk variable, configurable. So in my plugin, in the code that I use to build my list of plugins, I can just add a new key to the object, talk length. Pretty easy, yeah? And these options that you put here are automatically passed into the plugin at the moment that your initialization code is called. And the reason that we do that is that options are also dependencies of your code. A database without a connection string, yeah, that's nice, but that also breaks my code. So I want to know of that beforehand. So you can use default assertions for that. So in this case, I'm going to assert that an option called talk length is passed into my code, and then I can just use that. That's it. Just an options object with talk length. Other plugins won't ever notice. So if you now delete this from config, or you forget it, or your type is not correct, you can do crazy shit here. It will tell you, hey, talk length is required for the presentation plugin. So on a higher level, Architect allows you to be as specific as you want on your plugin depth. So you can write your models in like a very small class level thing, what you would do in Java or something, or very high in a feature level, what we do. That really depends on the size of your application. Because if you think chunks of functionality, so who of you have ever done Java or C Sharp or C++ or any traditional language? I did. All right. So let's say that you make a project, you know, you make a nice dependency. But the only thing you want to expose there is one single class. But you have interfaces and other dependencies, etc. So instead of, you have to give away a lot of the implementation of your module to consuming code. Maybe you have to expose like 50 classes or something just because. JavaScript has nice implicit type constraints, there's duck typing. So I can keep my implementation private. The only thing I have to say is, all right, this is a data layer. It has one function. That's all you need to know. It's black box coding. So when I'm using this code, I'm requiring my data layer. I'm calling this function. That's all I want to know. I don't want to know what comes out of it. I can just use duck typing for that. That's really nice. And because of that, I can also swap feature implementations very easily. So let's say that I want to replace my data layer here by one that runs on Mongo,
or Postgres, or
I don't care what you want to run there. I can just take my plugin, swap it completely out, make sure that the same functions are there, and none of my plugins will ever notice.
Cool.
So this is how we use it. Cloud9 has an open source version.
That's one.
But it also has as a hosted version. So we've actually got two products. And on the hosted version, you have like a normal thing with the free virtual machine. We also do FTP or SSH. So, and depending on the version that we run for you, we swap out complete sets of functionality or even load different ones. For example, if you want to do file system operations in Cloud9, it's going to tell, give me a file system that I can write files to. I don't want to know if I'm running FTP, I don't want to know if I'm running SSH, or I'm connecting to Dropbox, or whatever. That's the only thing I want to do. And we load a different plugin per implementation. So when you're open source, oh, we talk local file system for you. FTP, talk via an FTP library. SSH, we log in on your machine and create an SSH bridge. And our plugin code never has to know about this. Our plugin code just knows there's a file system. So here's something else you can build, and something that we use a lot in our code. And it's super easy if you do it the architect way. It's called a centralized event bus. Event buses are like the holy grail of software development. Everyone will know in 2013. A centralized event bus gives you the ability to not make hard dependencies. You know, if you ever made an image of your dependency tree on a large project on Java, then it's probably not going to fit on an A4 because everything is dependent on each other. An event bus gives you like loose coupling between plugins. Let's say one plugin emits an event. Think of it if you're doing it on the browser or something. Window.onClick. An event is emitted, another plugin can react on that. There's no hard dependency between those plugins. Because there is an event bus, they can still react on each other. So if you want to do that in Architect, this is all the code that you need. Get an event emitter, expose it, and now everyone can just import this event bus. A global event bus where you can use emit, where you can emit emit objects on in your whole application with like 8 lines of JavaScript. So you, and this is the way you should use it. I'm importing the event bus. When the presenter is doing like this dance, we emit a dancing event, and any other plugin can just react on that. Can subscribe to that event and get a notification without having a hard dependency on the presentation itself. So now my application grows and grows and grows, and I want to scale up with my event bus. I need something inter-server or something. Now I can take Redis PubSub or any other event bus mechanism. My plugins will never notice the difference. They just react to, they emit events and react to events. No one will notice, and now I run Redis PubSub. That's freaking awesome. So here are a couple of the lessons that we learned here when deploying this in our code base. This was me when I was 4. So modularize in feature blocks. You know, don't over-engineer. Don't try to be smart. Just create very high-level abstractions. Put the complete file system in a plugin, or put all the collaboration features that we have in a plugin. So let's say you want to disable that. Just comment out the line in the configuration, and voila, it's disabled. Don't create too small blocks. There are no interfaces. Because Architect can pass in different plugins for different environments, or pass in options, etc., can do a lot less context switching. way less if statements or something in your initialization code, because you let architect do that. So your code don't have to bother, if you're a file system, you don't have to bother, I'm not talking SSH, I'm not talking FTP. Right. Abstract it away in several modules, and your code slims down a lot. You know, less if statements, less mistakes, and less boilerplate as well. And if you want to do loose coupling, grab an event bus, because you create a way smaller dependency graph, you don't have circular dependencies everywhere, etc. All right, so if you want to play with this, you can check it out on GitHub. It's open source, github.com, C9, architect. If you want to play with Cloud9, it's on c9.io. I wish you a happy coding here.
All right, let's hear it for Jan Longbaum.
Something like that, yeah.
Close?
Yeah, weren't you supposed to do a dance? Wasn't that the end of the presentation? Did you want any questions? Or?
Yes, please.
Does anybody have any questions?
Yeah.
Do you have any thoughts about integrating this with NPM?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Can you repeat the question?
Do you have any thoughts about integrating this with NPM? I don't even know how to ask more specifically.
Yeah.
Just any ideas of directions to go, or maybe it's a bad idea. Specifically, I was thinking of, is it Express, where people have lots of problems with like sibling dependencies or something like that? Thank you.
So it's possible to make a plugin that can be used standalone on NPM, but it's also architect compatible. So that's really nice. So if you're going to use it normally, just NPM install blah. And if you want to do it architect style, you also NPM install it, but instead of it requiring it through common JS modules, you can just add it in your architect config, and then you can use the architect style. So there are a couple of things. So there's like a connect-based HTTP library already that you can use for that, where like host and port, etc. are all in config, so you can easily configure it as well. So they're compatible, but people need to change the code for that. Or you can create simple wrappers around libraries like Express, etc. with like 10 lines of code.
Good question. Any other questions? Anyone? No?
It can also be about Cloud9, the product or something, if you find that interesting.